I'm going to provide a really brief overview of the theory of prime behavior to hopefully help you better understand this theory. This theory was originally designed to predict a single instance behavior of voting, but since its original inception, it's been used to predict a multiple of health behaviors, including exercise, whether someone gets a vaccine or not, healthy eating behavior, condom use, etc. And where it comes from is that this theory predicts that someone's intention, so whether I intend to predict to perform that behavior, predicts very strongly whether I actually perform that behavior. So if I make an intention to exercise and go to the gym, I'm very likely that I actually will go and exercise and go to the gym. Whereas if I don't make that intention, it's very unlikely that I will actually perform that behavior. And there are three major constructs that predict someone's intention, and they're attitude, subjective norms, and perceived behavioral control. And I'm going to go through each one of these. They all predict intention, and again, attention predicts behavior. So we'll start with attitude first. So someone's attitude is their positive or negative thoughts about the performance of the behavior. And there's two main components to attitude. The first being behavioral beliefs. So these are what I think will occur as a result of performing the behavior. And I'm going to go into an example later around exercise. But for example, I might believe that if I exercise, this will take time away from my family. So that is negative. So it means that I'm unlikely to make the intention to exercise. Okay. The other part of attitude is outcome evaluation. And this goes along with behavioral beliefs. So these are whether I view these consequences as good or bad. So if I have the behavioral belief that exercise will lead to time away from my family, some of you might think that's a good thing. So that would be a positive outcome evaluation. So therefore, you'll have a good attitude towards it. And some people might think it's a bad thing to have time away from your family. So therefore, you'll have a negative outcome evaluation. Okay. So let's do that example. Let's do a couple examples for exercise. So let's look at our positive. So if I have the behavioral belief that if I exercise, my heart will get healthier, that is the behavioral belief. For outcome evaluation, this is whether I think that's important to me or not. And so for me, it's really important that I have a strong heart. So therefore, I would have a positive attitude. That positive attitude would predict intention, and that intention would predict behavior. Another example of this is that I might believe that if I exercise, I'm going to gain muscle strength. And for me, my outcome evaluation, how much I value that outcome, I value being strong because I want to be a strong grandma when I'm 80. So again, those things will lead me to form a positive attitude towards resistance training. I might intend to perform resistance training, and therefore I actually will. Conversely, I can have some very negative behavioral beliefs. So I might think if I exercise, this will take time away from my family, and my evaluation of that outcome is that it's really important for me to spend lots of time with my family. So I'm likely to have a negative attitude, I won't intend to exercise, and therefore I won't exercise. Another one that's quite common for people is that they, under behavioral beliefs, if they exercise, they'll think they'll get sweaty and sore. And for them, they really hate that outcome evaluation. They really hate getting sweaty and sore. So again, negative attitude, negative intention to exercise, negative behavior. So let's go back to attitude just to review this. So again, an attitude is someone's positive or negative thoughts about the behavior. And they're influenced by what I think will happen as a result of performing the behavior, behavioral beliefs, and how much I value that thing happening. That's outcome evaluation. So in addition to attitude, predicting intention, there's another construct called subjective norms. So we'll go through that right now. So subjective norms are basically the pressure, the social pressure you feel from others. And these are actual people in your life, not just society. So the social pressure you feel from people to perform a behavior. And our subjective norm is going to be predicted by two things. The first being normative beliefs. What I think subjective others expect me to do. And the second is motivation to comply. Am I motivated to comply with what others want me to do? You need to have both, because I might think lots of people in my life want me to do certain things, but if I'm not motivated to comply with that, that won't influence my behavior. So let's go back to that exercise example and look at two examples here. So let's look at someone who has a negative subjective norm. So they might believe that their partner or their family or anybody doesn't want them to exercise. And they're very much wanting to comply with what their partner or family wants. So this would lead them to have a negative subjective norm. They likely won't form the intention to exercise, and therefore they won't exercise. Another example is they might have others in their life that want them to exercise. So for example, you in this program, most of the teachers in this program want you to exercise. However, you might not care what your teacher wants. Okay, so you have to have both constructs positive to have a positive subjective norm. So if you know that your teachers want you to exercise, but you really could care less what they think, you're going to have a negative subjective norm, and that's not going to cause you to form the intention nor to exercise. Conversely, if we look at some positive subjective norms, so normative beliefs being my mother wants me to exercise, you may care very much what your mother wants you to do, so you're very motivated to comply. Another example of a positive normative belief is your friends expecting you to go to the gym with them. And for motivation to comply, you might really want to do what your friends want you to do. So this would have some positive subjective norms. They're expecting you at the gym. You really want to be there with your friends. You're likely going to intend to exercise and therefore exercise. So if we look at the final construct, which is called perceived behavioral control, this is going to predict both intention as well as behavior. And if you go back to social cognitive theory, this one is very much similar to self-regulatory efficacy. So if you understand that, you'll understand this. So there's two things that go into perceived behavioral control, the first being control beliefs. And this is the control someone feels they have over the question when there are behavioral barriers like work, family, weather, facilities. So again, like I said earlier, this is really similar to self-regulatory efficacy. What's different from social cognitive theory is this theory takes into account how often someone sees these barriers. So this is called control frequency. This becomes important because there are certain barriers in people's lives that they see much more often than others. So for example, in class I said, how many of you think that you can make it to class if there is a hurricane? So that would be control beliefs. Most of you probably don't think you're going to make it. But control frequency would be, how often in Toronto do we have hurricanes? Not very often, so that won't become very important. Whereas if I asked you how do you think you can make it to class if you're very stressed or have lots of work, that would be control beliefs. Control frequency is how often do you have lots of stress and lots of work? And I would guess that you probably have that quite frequently in your life. The interesting thing about perceived behavioral control is it affects both the intention and the behavior. So let's go back to our exercise example and have a look at some positive, negative perceived behavioral control. So for example, a control belief could be, I don't think I can make it to the gym when I'm stressed because of lots of work. And control frequency would be how often I'm stressed due to lots of work. So for example, someone might be very often stressed and they don't think they can make it. So they're going to have a very negative perceived behavioral control that they can make it to the gym. They're not going to make that intention, nor even if they make it that intention, it's going to get in the way of their exercise. If we go to the positive perceived behavioral control, someone might think that they can get to the gym even if they're really busy at school during exam period. And control frequency, this occurs very often in their life, but even if it's very often, if they think they can make it, they're going to make it. So this leads to positive perceived behavioral control, positive intention, and positive with regards to exercise. So if we go over the model entirely, for different behaviors, these constructs are going to affect people differently. So for example, for certain behaviors, attitude might be the most important. For others, it might be subjective norms, and for others, it might be perceived behavioral control. We might have positive for two of them and not for the other, or all three. All of them will lead to different predictions of intention and behavior. Now, you might be thinking the road to failure is paved with good intentions, and this is really quite true. Just because we make an intention doesn't mean we're going to perform the behavior. But if we never make the intention, we're never likely to perform the behavior. It won't just happen by accident. What this theory is best at predicting is single instance behaviors. So for example, acute behaviors. So like a vaccine versus chronic ones, like exercise. However, it can predict exercise. It's also best at attempting behaviors that are going to be performed in the immediate future. So very in the next week or two versus some later time. So next year. I hope this video has helped you understand theory of pattern behavior.